Hi. I'm Associate Professor Vida Engmann from University of Southern Denmark. And today, let's talk about energy. So, the energy consumption in the world is constantly on the rise. And according to the US Energy Information Administration, by year 2050, the per capita electricity consumption is expected to rise by 225%. And at the same time, the world population continues to expand. And by year 2050, there is supposed to be 60% more humans on the Earth. And if we try to continue producing all of this electricity from fossil fuels, we will be in a big trouble. We're already now witnessing the dangerous consequences of the global warming, which has been caused by our fossil fuel addiction. So, how can we find the sustainable energy that we need? Look at this bright and sunny day. In one single hour, the power from the sun that strikes the Earth is more than the whole world population consumes in 1 year. So, for this simple but remarkable reason, solar energy should be our first and preferred replacement for fossil fuels. It is universally available, and it is far less high risk than technologies such as nuclear power or carbon capture and sequestration. But to meet our future energy needs with renewable energies, the studies are showing that we should increase the solar fraction 60 times. Now that's really humongous. That's going to be the dawning of the age of the solar cells. But the thing is that with the current solar technologies, we will not be able to get that far. I mean, think of it. Think of the silicon panels, right? They're bulky. They're heavy. You need also pretty much a lot of space to mount it. You need to have solid mounting. So if you want to put it on your car, on your bicycle, it will be a big problem. And the social acceptance of silicon PV is already now it's a big problem. So already at these levels, just imagine how it will be when we install 60 times more. And silicon panels are not see-through, so I cannot just simply put them on a window. And there is also somewhat of a sustainability problem, I have to admit. So silicon requires high energy costs in order to grow it. And also in the whole process of the silicon PV processing, you're using and releasing toxic chemicals. Okay, so we have to find a way to have solar beyond silicon. I mean, this beautiful sunlight, we have to find a way that it's not reaching the surfaces for no reason. We have to find a way to use it to produce electricity with it. If we could only produce a thin, see-through type of a paint that could absorb all of this sunlight and then convert even a fraction of it into electricity and then just simply take the paint and paint all of the surfaces around us with that paint, we could turn every surface into practically a little electricity production site. We could truly energize the surfaces. And in fact, we can achieve exactly that with a novel solar technology, which is based on low-cost carbon-made molecules. Bulk heterojunction organic photovoltaics. Now, don't be freaked out by the big words. I'm going to say it slowly again. So it's bulk heterojunction organic photovoltaics. And what these somewhat big words actually stand for is a very simple and a very environmentally friendly energy technology. So what you do, you take a transparent conductor foil, then you take a bunch of these organic semiconducting molecules and you dissolve them in an ink-like solution. And then you simply print these organic molecules on top of this conducting foil. And all of this you're doing at room temperature and using a very simple technology, namely the inkjet printing. So it's the same type of thing that you use to print the newspapers with. So, of course, all of this makes this technology extremely affordable in price. But also, organic solar cells, they emit the lowest amount of CO2 per kilowatt produced as compared to all of the other renewable energy technologies. And also the nice thing about them is that it takes the least time to produce the amount of energy that you needed to create these organic solar cells. So their so-called energy payback time is the lowest. Now that makes these organic solar cells the true dream of every environmentalist. But they can be also made pretty. Yeah, you can use this technology to make thin, lightweight, see-through films. They can be flexible. They can come in any shape you want and in any color tint you can imagine. And you can integrate them on absolutely any surface you can think of. That means you can put them in modern buildings. You can embed them very nicely there. But you can just as well integrate them in all historic sites. So churches and old manors and the like. And they also have an additional bonus. So you can use them on indoor surfaces. So yes, you can actually produce electricity at low light and indirect sunlight conditions. Okay, and you can do that also at efficiencies, so power conversion efficiencies, which are higher than you would be able to do with silicon PV. So what am I still doing in the lab, and why am I not simply saving the world behind the printing wheel? So, organic solar cells, all of these appealing properties, they are there just because the organic solar cells are made from organic molecules. And organic matter, in general, has the same Achilles heel. Namely, they're sensitive to light, they're sensitive to heat, they're sensitive to oxygen. So all of these common stress factors that you find in our environment. And, what does it do to these organic molecules? So imagine an organic molecule and the light hits it. Especially the UV part of the light, because this is the high energy part of the light. And when that happens, the bonds between the atoms in such a molecule can easily break. And as they break, you create often radicals. Now, the radicals are very reactive species, and they can cause a lot of problems in our organic solar cells. They can cause the molecule to cross-link with itself, they can cause the molecule to start reacting with the surrounding oxygen, and they can even trap the flow of the electrons out of your organic solar cell. Now, all of these structural changes within the molecule, they will cause less absorption to be, less light to be absorbed by such a molecule, and also less electricity to be converted then by such a molecule. So, over time, when you have such sun-damaged devices, you will produce much less electricity. But this being a L'Oreal talk, I don't need to tell you that we have ways around sun damage, right? So just think of the way that we apply sunscreens to protect us from the harmful UV rays, or the way we use the anti-aging creams to neutralize the radicals that are formed in our skin over time and that prevent us from getting all wrinkly too fast. So That's also something that I'm kind of working with. I'm looking at how to bring this internal protection mechanism into the organic molecules that go into the organic solar cells. And the tricky part, without altering the electrical performance of such organic solar cells. So you could say that what I'm doing actually is designing sunscreens for organic solar cells at a molecular level. So, but of course, keeping this whole sunlight to electricity conversion efficiency the same. And this is a rather complex task, but thankfully I have nature to show me the way. So if you think of the leaves, for example, they're already designed to prevent degradation from taking place. So if you would zoom into a leaf, you would see chloroplasts. You would see these basic units which take part in photosynthesis process. And if you look in the chloroplast, you will see the chlorophylls, which are nicely protected by carotenoid molecules. What I do, I try to create nanocapsules that replicate these chloroplasts and contain similar type of antioxidants inside. And then I use these nanocapsules to fabricate stabilized organic solar cells. And so far, I have identified special antioxidants from nature, such as beta-carotene, which can really significantly enhance the lifetime of such organic solar cells. And now my next step, what I'm doing is I'm trying to embed this into a nanocapsule platform. And this way I will be able to provide the stability to solar cells, but at the same time maintain these appealing organic and electronic properties of these fantastic organic molecules. And I actually do believe that this will be the way to make this dream of energizing the surfaces become a reality. And I also actually believe that the way forward in general is by following the nature's lead. So this whole nano capsule platform, it can be added more and more bio-related features to it so that we can generate novel advanced printed electronic technologies based on what the nature has provided us with. And if you look at the pace in which these printed electronic technologies are developing, I am certain that such bio-inspired approaches will be critical in meeting these grand challenges that lie ahead of us concerning the climate change and the global warming. Thank you.